Hello everybody, and welcome back to a new video on my channel. The title of this video is Sara Forbes Bonetta, Queen Victoria's African Goddaughter. If you are new to the channel, hello there, and be sure to stay and check my other videos. I usually upload on Sundays, and I talk about Black British history, that is any history about Black and other non-whites in the UK and the British Empire. Don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button and keep notified. Link to my PayPal is in the description. Did you know that Queen Victoria had an African goddaughter? Sara Forbes Bonetta was from Oke Odan, Yoruba land. She was born in 1843 and her birth name was Omoba Aina or Ina. She was a princess of the Egbado clan of the Yoruba people. In 1995, the Egbado clan changed their name to Yewa, named after the Yewa River, a transnational river which runs through Nigeria and Benin. The Yewa River was named after the Yoruba goddess Yewa. Unfortunately, Bonetta was orphaned during a war with the Kingdom of Dahomey and was captured as a slave by Gezo, the new king of Dahomey. Bonetta was a young child when she was enslaved. She was given as a gift to British Royal Naval officer Captain Frederick E. Forbes. She was soon baptized where Queen Victoria was her godmother. As I said, Sara came from Oke Odan in Yoruba land. At the time when she was born, Oke Odan was a village independent from the Oyo Empire that had fallen 7 years earlier. The Oyo Empire was one of the most powerful empires of West Africa and comprised the largest Yoruba population, lasting from 1300 up until 1836, although the former year is contested. One of the main things that the empire is known for is its invasion of the Kingdom of Dahomey, in which the empire did 11 times before the Dahomey was eventually subjugated by them in 1748. Under a treaty in that year, Dahomey was also forced to pay an annual tribute of 41 men, 41 virgins, 41 guns, 400 bags of cowries and 400 corals to the Oyo Empire, a humiliating process. When Gezo became the new king of Dahomey in 1818, after replacing his older brother Aidan Dozan in a coup, a lot of the things changed. Gezo was rebellious and refused to pay tribute to the Oyo Empire, focusing on the sovereignty of Dahomey. He declared Dahomey as independent, but of course, the Oyo Empire tried everything to prevent Gezo's wishes. Because of Gezo, Dahomey's economy started to rebuild. According to historian Augustus A. Adeyinka, the year 1818 provides the first evidence of the military and political weakness of Oyo and the ascendance of Dahomey as a power to be reckoned with in Yoruba-Dahomey power politics. Dahomey then succeeded in placing the Oyo Empire on the defensive. It took 9 years for Gezo to achieve his first victory against Oyo forces. But his ambitions for further conquests went too far. Even though he was a liberator of Dahomeans, he turned Kingdom of Dahomey into a slave economy, where even when the British told him to abstain from participating in the Atlantic slave trade, he didn't. The reasoning being that slavery was the sole reason to why his kingdom was succeeding, and abolishing it would mean Dahomey would descend into anarchy. After his victory in 1827, it gave him the courage to expand his conquests, which were mostly successful. In 1848, he captured Oke Odan, when Sara was just 5 years old. In 1849, 30-year-old naval officer Captain Frederick E. Forbes was sent on a diplomatic mission to Dahomey to convince King Gezo to abolish slavery. Forbes had already been in West Africa, serving with the warship HMS Penelope on another mission. The reason for this is that while Britain ended its involvement in the Atlantic slave trade in 1807 and abolished slavery in 1833, other countries such as the United States, Spain and Portugal were still involved in the slave trade. As Portuguese traders sent larger numbers of enslaved Africans to Brazil, Britain sought to end enslavement in Africa through negotiations and raids on foreign ships. Gezo did offer the gradual ending of slavery if Britain encouraged the expansion of trade of Dahomey palm oil to counter neighbouring Egba state of Abeokuta, whom Dahomey was at war with. However, this offer was refused and the Royal Navy imposed an embargo of Dahomey ports in March 1851. Gezo then offered the abolition of slavery if Britain paid reparations to Gezo for the loss of income. Again, Britain rejected the offer. From January 1852, Gezo ended the transportation of enslaved people from Dahomey ports, but continued to transport people to neighbouring states from which they were sent to the Americas. Up until 1858, Gezo reduced the number of people enslaved. However, after this, Gezo became hostile to Britain again and resumed most of the policies of enslavement pre-1852. It was custom for King Gezo and Forbes to exchange gifts to each other. One day, the king offered Forbes a rich country cloth, a captive girl, a cabassier's stool, and a footstool. The captive girl being Sarah. She was held in captivity for 2 years in a small room. She had scars in her face, though specific scars strongly suggesting she was of royal blood. Sometimes other captives were dressed in white and bound, taken into caskets to be sacrificed before the king. Gezo described Sarah as a present for Queen Victoria. Forbes later wrote, "One of the captives of this dreadful slave hunt was this interesting girl. It is usual to reserve the best born for the high behests of royalty and the immolation on the tombs of the deceased nobility." Forbes also said that refusing to accept the girl would have been to have signed her death warrant, which probably would have been carried into execution forthwith. Forbes hurried back to his ship, HMS Bonetta, with the girl and named her Sarah, with her middle name being named after his surname and her surname being named after his ship. On the voyage back to England, Sarah was surrounded by white male sailors, but by the time they reached England, she could already speak English. Forbes wrote to his superiors, informing them what had happened. Forbes had a wife and children and was planning to bring Sarah up himself. Forbes wrote, "She is a perfect genius. She now speaks English well and has a great talent for music. She is far in advance of any white child of her age in aptness of learning and strength of mind and affection." Initially, she stayed with the Forbes family, but after Queen Victoria was touched by Sarah's story, Queen Victoria decided to take her in instead. In November 1850, Queen Victoria asked for her to visit Windsor Castle. She also met Prince Albert and six of their children. Describing the occasion, a newspaper said that the girl was mostly kindly shaken by the hand of Her Majesty and her royal children, and went through the interview with great self-command. Queen Victoria gave her the nickname of Sally. Queen Victoria kept a diary for most of her life. In November 9th, 1950, she wrote, "When we came home, found Albert still there, waiting for Captain Forbes and a poor little Negro girl, whom he brought back from the Kingdom of Dahomey, her parents and all her relatives having been sacrificed. Captain Forbes saved her life by asking for her as a present. She was brought into the corridor. She is 7 years old, sharp and intelligent, and speaks English." In 1851, Sarah was sent to the Church Missionary Society School in Freetown, Sierra Leone. At this time, she had suffered coughs, and there was a widespread belief that the English climate was detrimental to African health. Additionally, she was sent there with the intention that Sarah should become a missionary herself. While she was there, the Queen continued to send her presents and books. However, she was reportedly unhappy, and after 4 years, she returned to England. Victoria sent Sarah to live with the Shone family, who were former missionaries in Africa and now lived in Gillingham, Kent. She lived with them for 6 years before moving to Brighton, against her wishes, since Sarah was very happy living with the Shone family. She was in her late teens when she moved to Brighton, and a woman called Miss Welsh oversaw her introduction to British society. When she was 19 years old, James Pinson Labulo Davies, a Yoruba merchant, expressed an interest in her, and a marriage was arranged for her. However, Sara was against it and did not like him. In a letter to Mrs. Schoen, she said, "Others would say he is a good man, and though you don't care about him now, will soon learn to love him. That I believe I never could do. I know that the generality of people would say he is rich, and your marrying him would at once make you independent. And I say, am I to barter my peace of mind for money? No, never." Despite her rejections, the wedding went ahead and they got married in 1862 in St. Nicholas's Church, Brighton, East Sussex. History PhD researcher Hannah Cusworth notes that Sara did not use her British given name on her marriage record, but used her birth name Aina instead. James Davies was born in Sierra Leone, then a British colony, to parents James and Charlotte Davies, who were Sierra Leonean Creoles of Yoruba ancestry. He was 15 years older than Sara, having been born in 1828, and was previously married to a Cuban woman named Matilda Bonifacio Serrano. Unfortunately, she died 9 months after their marriage. Davies was of great importance in Africa, in West Africa, as he pioneered coca farming over there as he introduced it to the region. He was previously a naval officer on the HMS Bloodhound, a vessel of the British Royal Navy, the same one which ousted Oba Kosoko, with the goal of ending the slave trade. Kosoko was a ruler of Lagos from 1845 to 1851. He spread his knowledge of coca farming to the West African region using seeds that he obtained from a Brazilian ship and the island of Bioko, an island that belongs to Equatorial Guinea. At the time, the island was called Fernando Po, as the country was colonized by the Spanish. The couple soon moved to Sierra Leone and then to Lagos, since Davies' business was based in Africa. In 1863, they had their first child, Victoria. Queen Victoria also became her godmother. In December 1867, Victoria was christened, and the Queen sent her a gold cup, salver, which is a tray made of silver and typically used for formal occasions, knife, fork and spoon. Writing about little Victoria, the Queen wrote in her diary, "After luncheon, saw Sally, now Mrs. Davis, and her dear little child, far blacker than herself, called Victoria, and age 4, a lively, intelligent child with big, melancholy eyes." Sara and James had 2 more children, called Arthur and Stella, but she was suffering from a chronic cough that she inherited after she came to England, and it developed into tuberculosis. As a result, her husband sent her to Funchal, Madeira, hoping the climate would ease her illness, but it did not work. Shortly after moving there, she died on August 15, 1880. On August 23, 1880, Queen Victoria wrote, "Grieved and shocked to hear that poor Sally, Mrs. Davies, was hopelessly ill at Madeira. Lie Dudley brought her 4 eldest children for me to see, 3 fine, nice boys and a very little pretty girl." I'm not sure why Queen Victoria mentions 4 children here when Sara had 3. Upon her death, Queen Victoria wrote in her diary, "Saw poor Victoria Davies, my black godchild, who learnt this morning of the death of her dear mother at Madeira. The poor child was dreadfully upset and distressed and only got the news as she was starting to come here. Victoria seems a nice girl. I shall give her annuity." Victoria Davies was sent annuity and a golden christening set. Sara's husband placed a granite obelisk-shaped monument that is 8 feet high in her memory in Ijon, Western Lagos, where he started a coca farm. It reads, "In memory of Princess Sara Forbes Bonetta, wife of the Honorary James Pinson Labulo Davies, who departed this life at Madeira, August 15th, 1880, age 37. 9 years after Sara died, James Davies married another African woman named Catherine Kofa-Worola Raffle until his death in 1906 in colonial Lagos. Just a year after James Davies married, Victoria Davies married Dr. John Randall, a Scottish-trained Nigerian doctor who was born in Sierra Leone. Victoria and John had two children together, Beatrice, named after Queen Victoria's daughter, Princess Beatrice, and John, presumably named after his father. With them, they all visited Queen Victoria in November 1900, just a few months before Queen Victoria died. Unfortunately, Victoria Davies' marriage fell apart and she lived in exile with her children, first in the UK and then in Sierra Leone, before returning back to Lagos in 1917. She died in 1920. During her stay in London, she became friends with Black British composer Samuel Coleridge Taylor. Today, there are living descendants of Sara Forbes Bonetta, including a Sierra Leonean man named Arnold Orna Gordon, who lives in Kent and is in his 80s. Thank you for watching this video, and I hope you have enjoyed it.